Hello and welcome to channel4hotball.com. My name is Caleb Durward and this is a brain in a jar modern brew. It has been dubbed bird brain by some of my Twitch viewers. I'm not the first person who ever combined brain in a jar and Beck and Call in a deck. Even when brain in a jar was first spoiled, people were talking about it on forums and stuff. But the build is original. I brewed this up on stream during the Halloween stream. I had always had the combo kind of in the back of my head, thinking like, well, maybe this is worth testing out. With the idea that it's like probably not very good in modern because there's so many incidental artifact hate cards. There's people are main decking cards like Colgan's Command, and then they bring in cards like Ancient Grudge and Stony Silence and whatnot. So there's just a lot of hate for artifacts in the format. But if you can build a deck that's resilient enough, a deck that has enough other angles of attack, then it's like kind of difficult to bring in too much hatred for the brain in the jar strategy with this build. Because we've got cards like Thirst for Knowledge and stuff. Now, people that aren't familiar with the combo, people that aren't familiar with Brain in the Jar and Fuse cards, the way it works is you put a counter on Brain in the Jar and you can cast a one drop or whatever. You can like probe your opponent during their draw step or something. See that extra card? Turn your probe into a peek. Or you can just like use it to counter something with a dispel or cast the path or whatever. Anyway, you get the one counter on it. Then when you get the two counter on it, you can suddenly activate it to cast Beck and Call, right? Because Beck is two, and then when you go to cast the card from your hand, because Brain in the Jar casts it from your hand, you're allowed to choose the Fuse option on it, which means you get to put 4/1/1s into play and draw four cards. You basically get to fuse a Beck and Call as early as turn three in this deck, which is pretty powerful. It's pretty powerful to have a full Lingering Souls, and I'll draw four cards. Because the four cards that you're going to draw are going to be a pile of Cryptic Commands, Snapcasters, Path to Exiles, and more Brain in the Jars and Beck and Calls, right? There are definitely turns where I was sitting there with like two Brain in the Jars in play and like, well, I hope I draw a Beck and Call soon. Oh, hey, a Beck and Call. And then that one draws me another Beck and Call. And then the Beck starts stacking because... And so then the second one, you draw eight cards. You draw 12 cards total in a turn. This is very difficult to lose from those situations. And in the grindy matchups, and it seems like that wouldn't like come together that consistently, but it does relatively consistently. And then in the grindy matchups where you don't piece the combo together, you can still cast the Beck and Call, right? Like if your opponent's trying to race you, then that means that they don't have a ton of disruption for the actual combo. So you can fire it off earlier with the Brain in the Jar. And if your opponent's not trying to race you, if they're just trying to like play a grindy control-ish style game with a lot of disruption, then at a certain point, you're going to get to 8 mana, right? Like, if your opponent's pathing your thing in the ices, they are getting you to the 8 mana to just cast, hard cast fuse the Beck and Call, which comes up. It comes up every once in a while. It's not very common. It comes up probably, like, once in 5 matches or something like that. But the fact that it happens at all was surprising to me, because 8 is so much mana in Modern. Anyway, so I brewed this deck up on stream, and I was thinking it was going to be kind of a joke, you know, like, Brain in the Jar, Halloween, this is fun, you know? But it was actually winning. It was actually winning. The first iteration of the deck went 3-2 in a league, and I was like, all right, well, I'm going to make a couple tweaks here, fire it off again. And then the second iteration went 4-1. And the one loss I had, I was like ahead in game three and lost on time. So I was like, well, maybe there's something vaguely competitive about this idea. So I made a couple more tweaks even, and then and now I'm going to run this through the third league for you folks at home, see if we can pull off another winning record with this crazy brew that we've got going on here. I did try a heavier green splash. At first I was playing two Breeding Pools and I had like some Tarmogoyfs whiffs in the sideboard and stuff, but the Monastery Mentors out of the board were really performing well. They play along very nicely with the Thing in the Ice plan. Well, if you have a Thing in the Ice, you don't really want to bounce all your mentor tokens, but the shell complements them both, right? The pile of like Jataxian Probes and Serum Visions and Snapcasters flashing back spells and stuff plays very well with both mentor and Thing in the Ice. So if you're playing against a deck that has like, say, Liliana of the Veil, where Thing in the Ice isn't necessarily that consistent, you can just swap in the mentors. There's a lot of matchups where Thing in the Ice is better, and decks like Boggles and whatnot, or Infect, decks where like the upheaval, or not upheaval, the evacuation aspect of the flip is like really, really key. I'm not really sure which of those two cards is better in the main deck, and to like sub in for the other. But so far, I think Thing in the Ice is a little bit better. We'll see for sure. One nice thing about having mentors in the sideboard is that if I feel like the Brain in the Jar, Beck and Call combo is being particularly targeted, I can always, like, shave combo pieces and bring in mentors and just, like, brick their artifact disruption that way, right? And then play, like, a like kind of a typical blue-white aggro control deck. There are a few considerations in the sideboard. Rest in Peace is mostly a hoser for Dredge and Living End and whatnot. I'm not sure if it's necessary. I'm not sure if it should be something else. You don't board it in against most opponents, right? You're not boarding in Rest in Peace against Tarmogoyf decks, because the deck is actually really, really keen on Snapcaster Mage. Snapcaster Mage is a big, big reason that you can compete with the other top decks in Modern. So turning that off is kind of a no-no. Then I'm playing Disenchant and Hercule's Recalls instead of something like Stony Silence, because again, we need the Brain in the Jar combo to actually work, right? We want to be able to activate it, and you can't do that if you've got a Stony Silence in play. But Hercule's Recall is a really good hoser as well, so that's been solid. And then the Supreme Verdicts aren't something that I've really gotten a chance to test yet, but there were a few matchups where I wanted access to them post-board, so they're the slots that I'm the least excited about in the sideboard, but I think they're worth testing. All right, with no further ado, let's get into some matches. I hope you guys are... Hope you guys are excited for some Bird Brains. Hey, how's it going, everybody? Let's see. Would you like to play first? Yes. Yes, of course. Yeah, sure. With a hand like this, where I'm like a little bit short on actual spells, I'm just going to sit back on the Serum Visions. Play turn 2, Thing in the Ice. Play turn 3, Serum Visions, Hold Up Remand. Or maybe turn 3, Thing in the Ice plus Serum Visions now. We shall see. We shall see. Yeah, let's jam it. Probably gonna get countered. Nope, okay. Kind of wonder what the opponent's sitting on. Path, probe. I like probe. I'm not sure I like path with this limited information that we got going on, but I think I'm gonna keep it anyway. Sometimes blue white red is a little reliant on like Colonnade or Resto to finish the game out, and then path can be really strong. We might just be facing a blue red deck though. Is this a Blood Moon? Awesome. Get a sneaky peek on out of pin here. Yeah, so there's a lot. Oh, they must have drawn the Spell Snare like right after we got the second Thing in the Ice down. That's kind of unfortunate for them. Yeah, so the awesome thing about playing against Blue Moon, like straight blue-red, is that they don't actually have very many answers to Thing in the Ice. And we have two Thing in the Ices in play. Like, they don't have Path to Exile, right? Because their mana base is warped around the Blood Moon. Meanwhile, our mana base is like actually pretty good against Blood Moon. Not because we like warped our mana base at all, just because we happen to play a lot of basics. We just don't have very many heavy mana heavy requirements in that sense. I'm just gonna thirst now. Holding up remand isn't actually that good. The opponent didn't really have a handful of cards worth remanding, and we know that they're sitting on Spell Snare, so. Okay, Dispel is interesting. I like discarding Hollowed Fountain. I think I'm going to discard Hollowed Fountain Path here. And then I'm going to pass the turn. Yeah, Dispel Snap seems pretty strong. Brain in a Jar. Probably not doing much work this game. Let's see. El Snapperoonie. And I think I'm just going to remand my own Snapcaster. Sweet. Tough game, right? Tough game. Yeah, I think people are just starting to realize that the thing in the ice is actually very, very strong. So Dispel seems good. Negates seem good. Mentors seem good. Got a lot of cards that we could bring in. Yeah, let's do like this. And then shave either a probe or a remand, maybe. Maybe just like cut a sleight of hand. I want to keep in the combo. They didn't see any of the combo out of us, so still got that surprise potential. Yeah, let's cut a probe and the sleight of hand. Bring in two mentor, bring in another copy of Dispel, and a couple negates. And then leave the probe in. Or do I want the sleight of hand over the fourth probe? Dum-de-dum-dum-dum. I think this is legit. We might want to board in Disenchant, depending on how this next game goes. Like, if they're playing Vidalkin Shackles. Cryptic Command can, like, give me a way to plow through that. How about this hand, huh? I think this is a mull. We can keep this one. Serum Vision's a little bit better than Probe It, helping you hit your second land drop. And now we have a Scry too, so yeah, we're just gonna keep that. Okay. Serum Vision's not the worst thing to see from the opponent, but they're also gonna be hitting their land drops. I probably should have shocked myself with the Hollowed Fountain. I want both of these. So the reason to shock yourself with Hollowed Fountain there is because we didn't know that we were going to have a second land necessarily, or like one that like naturally comes into play untapped. And shocking myself for the Hollowed Fountain would kind of hide that. Yeah, I'd kind of like to remand that, but I also want to top deck the Cryptic Command that's on top of my library. Cool. And then we want to get into a situation where we can play Mentor with like Dispel up and stuff. Is that worth firing off? Almost, right? I think I want one more land drop before I make a play for Thing in the Ice. Because then I can have Remand and Dispel up. If I have to crack this Floated Strand, I'm not sure if I'm getting a basic Plains or a basic Island yet. I kind of want to start playing things. The reason I got a Plains is because we can like cantrip into another island. There's plenty of islands in the deck. when I remanded their own relic. Yeah, sure. I like playing Brain in a Jar. What if I just slammed Brain in a Jar and Thing in the Ice and passed the turn here? What's the worst that I could get punished? I could also play Mentor and just pass with Dispel up. Mentor gets answered by a lot more though, I think. That pause as the opponent realizes that I'm playing with Brain in the Jar in my deck. Roast? Okay. That's a solid answer. Also would have cleared the Mentor if we just passed with Dispel up there. Cool. Once again, I kind of want one more mana in play, right? Because then I could play Dispel and Remand to protect Mentor. At this point, I think the game is going to come down to whether or not I draw a Beck call and then, like, win a counter war over it. Okay, Thirst is interesting. Yeah, I'm just going to pass again. You usually don't want to tick up Brain in a Jar up to Thirst intentionally. You usually want to leave the Brain in a Jar on one counter so that if you draw it back and call, you can like immediately cash it in. Go to remain my own Thirst. Very similar to what they did when we got in a counter war over Relic. Now I could play Snapcaster target Serum Visions and see what they do. I actually don't hate that. And then go for end of turn Thirst again. Because if they first pop Relic here, yeah, then one, they're exiling their own graveyard, so their own Snapcasters are weaker. And then for two, now my future Snapcasters can actually get turned on. Yeah, that's absolutely fine. I could have attempted to Cryptic Bounce my Snapcaster there and draw a card, but I think it's better to wait. No need to rush things. I think Thirsting here is okay. Awesome. And I believe that means we win. I'm just going to bin both of these lands. activate brain. Click the fuse button. And wait for the opponent. Oh, please don't have the uncounterable one. They have the uncounterable one. And we don't have remand. We don't have remand to save our beck and call. This is so sad. I'm so sad right now. Oh no. Specifically counterflux. Counterflux is so strong. Now what happens if I go for mentor and they like snap cast back counterflux? I'm gonna be so sad. I was like so happy to cantrip with my remands too. Okay, is there anything that I can do here? I don't think so, right? Yeah, there's just nothing. Alright. I guess I should have led with mentor. The good news is the brain in a jar is not spent, like it's still in play. We can like scry with it or whatever. When you're playing on Magic Online, you want to always yield the mentor triggers, and it just makes the card a lot more pleasant to play with. And then every time a new monk goes into play, you do the auto yields on that one. Otherwise, you get this like stack of like five or six things that are making like two triggers every time anything happens, and it's miserable. But it's pretty solid if you keep up with it. We could have scryed on upkeep there, but I didn't think it was worth it. Because if you tap the brain to scry, then it's not like you can... if you find a beck and call, it's not like you can use the brain that turn anyway. I'm actually considering using it to fire off the Thirst for Knowledge. EOT Cryptic A. Opponent's down to one card in hand. So they have an open turn to answer the mentor. If they like top decked an answer to it. But even then, like there's still the monks to deal with. So they'd almost have to go like electrolyze clear two monks into an answer to the mentor. It just doesn't seem very likely, right? And even if they did all that, our hand is still awesome. Our hand is like negate Thirst for Knowledge Snapcaster. We can even cast the Thirst for Knowledge if we want to at their end of turn. I probably don't want to, but it's an option. We just don't have any like chaff that we want to filter away right now. Maybe I'll cast it anyway, just because it's free. Oh no. They backed in the match. Okay, cool. So the combo like came together that game, and it would have been very good if there wasn't counterflex specifically. But that's not like a mark against the combo. It's not like a thing you should be thinking about, right? It's not a reason not to play the combo. It's that your opponent might have counterflux. It just happened. It's just a weird eccentricity of modern so that you can occasionally play against that card. And the deck itself still won, so yay, yay deck. On to the next round.